the energy resource and as well as the
Hello?
More about like how to calculate the charge of energy.
Hi, Francesco.
Hello, Domenico. Hi. Hi.
The next decade.
I find you also the co-host role because I'm in between two calls and maybe you can help the transition. Hi, Bruno. Welcome. Now let's wait. The participant will join. Then we can start the discussion. And maybe both of you can have a round of introduction. So first of all, Francesco is one of the climate leaders of Climate Reality Project. He's very active in energy and also helping also suggesting solution for the Piano Area Clima in Milan. But I will leave the floor to Francesco to present. And Bruno is from Unione Geotermica Italiana, and he's an expert of geothermic energy. And yeah, now let's wait for people eventually to join.
Interviewing people from different sectors, private, the academic sector, and even government regarding energy transition and energy.
Hello, Bruno. Nice meeting you.
Hi. Now, dears, let's wait. Maybe I will share a little bit the link, and then Francesco, you can also allow the people to enter. As I said, I also give you the privilege of co-hosting, so you can eventually allow the people to join. And now let's wait another 5 minutes.
I will get the request to join.
Sorry?
So if someone wants to join, I will get the request myself.
Yes. You can see the request and you can allow the people to enter.
Okay, great.
You will also join Rodrigo, that is from Colombia, if I remember well. He's from an organization, an NGO, that is working on energy access. Energy Mining Dialogue, the NGO is a Latin America Energy Mining Dialogue, Rodrigo Andrade. And your goal of the table is to discuss about the driving the ambition toward energy transition and from access to energy to the right of energy.
Thank you. Bruno, shall we have a chat while we wait? I cannot hear you.
Sorry. Now,
hello.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you. And we have also Giancarlo joining.
Yes, nice to meet you too. How many are we supposed to be in the round table?
It depends because the people are selecting the parallel session, but I think that we can start because the meeting will be registered. So welcome to all, and thank you for Bruno and Francesco to join. The goal of this table and this very ambition is to how to drive the ambition for climate transition, for energy transition, and think beyond the concept of access to energy to reach the right of energy. So we have with us Francesco Cara from Climate Clarity Project. He's also expert in energy solutions and also collaborating with the Climate Clarity Project about solution for the Piano del Clima. And Bruno Della Vedova is from Unione Geotermica Italiana. He also contributed with a wonderful speech for Climate Social Forum regarding the geothermal energy. The floor is yours for two like long speeches, a speech of 5 minutes each. You can take more minutes, and then let's interact and discuss on this topic, also with the participants. Thanks.
Wonderful. Bruno, go ahead.
Okay.
Please.
But why don't you open it up, given a little bit of more description of the target, of the goal, also connected to the other, I would say, parallel sessions going on. I'm a little bit, you know, sort of lost because it's the first time I'm joining this Climate Social Forum, which I think it's a very good idea because it's a bottom-up sort of punching people to let the brain and the neurons work, right?
Okay, I will add a few hints also regarding the previous sessions. With the previous session, we were with Andrea Micangeli from Res4Med. And he has thought about the microgrids, and he's a builder of microgrids in Africa and in other developing country contests. And he opened the floor for the topic of access to energy, how to make the energy more accessible, and also to like take this as a way to grant the right of energy, because energy it's becoming a right also, and also renewable energy in a way can represent a way that we can take for grant more energy for all, and also different energy, because there is not just solar, for example, there is geothermal, there is wind, and so on, and how these new energy can grant and facilitate the access to energy rather than the fossil fuels, for example. This is one point. Another point is how to implement also that in a social way. So considering a just transition, this is something that related to the session of tomorrow, but of course the energy transition need also to be just and respect the rights of the people and so on.
Okay, thank you for this frame overview, which let us start our round table, though we are three of us, but we'll try to do our best. I think access to energy is one pillar of the human rights and also of the sustainable development goals. Access to energy will help people for sure having a better living quality, having for sure access to education, and having for sure, a possibility and opportunity to reduce inequalities in order to include, in order to cooperate. Otherwise, they will be out of business. And if you consider that at least 2 billion people are not having access to electricity. When we say energy, we have two main pillars, power and heat. Heat is something that was taken care of since the ancient times and the primitive populations. They were taken care of by themselves for heat. And some of them are even now taking care of heat in the same way nowadays. But electricity is the other leg of energy access, which makes people connected. When we talk about internet, when we talk about artificial intelligence, when we talk about big data, when we talk about, live communication, we need electricity. No way. How can we approach that? Well, it's quite a tricky problem because it requires policy from one side and investment. If there are no policies on energy, the most popular policies are on fossil fuels, not very many on sustainable so far. If you go on the REN21 renewable energy report, you see that renewables are still, are important, but not that heavy in terms of sharing. 80% of the energy demand is on fossil fuels, and 11% is on renewables, and something as 6-7% is on biomass and 2% on nuclear. So renewables have 11% of the share. Most of it is hydropower. So there's quite a huge margin of improvement everywhere, but we need policy. 130, 140 countries around the world have already addressed that. Policy for energy and for renewables, not only for fossil fuels. The other aspect is that we need investment. Policy and investment, they go together. They are quite strongly linked and interrelated. If you look at the World Bank, if you look at the European Bank of Investment, if you look at the major funds around the world, they are supporting renewables and development, but they need policies, they need projects, and they need guarantees. And therefore, the problem is not easy. On the other hand, if we want to have power, energy access, we developers, producers, and so they need to work on three main pillars. They need to project and work on distribution systems. They need to work on production, systems to produce energy, systems to distribute energy, and systems to supply energy. That's already mature as a market, but only in the advanced countries. In the third world countries, there are still lots of, gaps to be filled up. Another major point I'm coming from academia. I was used to be a professor of applied geophysics at the University of Trieste for several years. Though I've been involved in projects in renewable energies, mainly geothermal, okay, around the world, and working with the Unione Geotermica Italiana and with the International Geothermal Association, the IGA. What we need particularly is to invest, and that could be bottom up, on education. And mainly nowadays that you see that there are lots of fake news all over and anti-science people talking and news and media. And people get confused. We need to invest on education. Education is a very basic background on which to start from. And from education and training, then we could invest on development, investing in small energy business in the developing countries. But even in our country, we need to start innovation for small business. We need to change a paradigm and culture, and I would say a business model do not change by itself. Forget it. We need energy, we need young ideas, we need people from the bottom to start doing that, because huge and big industries and governments are inertial in that sense. They are waiting for the from the input from below. So I would say the renewables have a great deal of things to be done, and there's plenty of room for everybody to work on and to start contributing for this access to energy and energy right everywhere, not only in the third world countries, even in our country. I mean, if the energy demand is supported by 80% of fossil fuels, that means something, even in Italy. You know, gas, the majority of electricity in Italy is produced by gas. Gas is a fossil fuel. Come on. And there's plenty all over, even in the advanced countries. So we need education, we need training, and we need people to start. And now is a good moment, I would say, a good momentum. The pandemic and the outbreak of the pandemic, now everybody's talking about the health, which is fundamental, the health of everybody. We are taking care, but we should not forget the other questions, energy, food, water. Okay, I guess I took too much time. I shut off, I let the floor to you, thanks.
So maybe taking somewhere else, Domenico. So my name is Francesco Cara, and I'm from the Climate Reality Project, which is the movement that Al Gore created, set up in 2006. And what we do is quite a lot of educational work. So we spend a lot of time in schools, in universities, in associations, in companies to talk about the climate crisis and especially the solutions. And then we do activism and participate. For instance, at the moment, I'm very much involved in the discussions around the plan, air and climate of the city of Milan. So we contribute to the works, sort of to the changes that are happening in relation to our societies. I think that what Bruno was saying is really important. When I look at the issue of access to energy and right to energy, I really think to all the millions of people, I was checking the latest IEA data, and the latest numbers are 610 million people with no access to electricity, a relatively nice decrease or increase in the number of people who are connected, but that has been slowing down dramatically because of the pandemics. So these numbers, according to the IEA, will go up over the next few years. But then the other thing is the energy poverty. So the other aspect is really in urban environments, in the industrialized and industrializing world alike, people who live in geographical areas, in regions where there are electricity networks, there is electricity production, but simply they do not have the means to pay to satisfy their energy needs. So these are two questions. They seem to me two very different questions that require different approaches, different takes. Regarding the first one, the access to energy, we have a way of looking at that issue within the Climate Reality Project, which uses the analogy with what has happened with telecommunications. If you think of the world of telecommunications, before mobile phones, you had to set up incredibly expensive networks to get access to telecom services around the world. And then with the mobile networks, the access to telecoms became much easier because you didn't have to put cables across large countries, but antennas were enough, and then you had devices to connect that were relatively affordable. I worked for Nokia for many years, and we saw a fantastic uptake of mobile technologies in many non-industrialized countries and developing countries. And around them also the development of a lot of economic activity, starting from shops who would sell phones and service phones, shops who would charge phones, people who were using phones as a means of payment. And we saw a lot of development around those areas. So we use very much that analogy to think about access to energy. With similarly to mobile phones, relatively inexpensive technologies. And what we have seen, again, I was checking the IEA report, and actually a lot of the development that has happened, the access that has been made available to more and more people, renewables, in particular solar, is playing a massive role with standalone technologies as well as microgrids. I'm a designer myself, and what I found absolutely fantastic is the work that Olafur Eliasson, the artist, has done with the Little Sun project, which are these lamps that have a solar panel at the back that are sold for around 20 euros in industrialized countries and become available at a much lower price in Africa in particular. This one is another model, it's a diamond, uses the same principle. And around those type of products, and there are more and more of those products, there is a very low entry level access to electricity. The numbers are still small because we are talking, in the case of the Olafur Eliasson Little Sun project, we're talking of over a million families now having access to electricity for their studies, for their education, to go to the toilet outside of their house, to work during the night. So there are lots of those bottom-up projects, which are really interesting, with more and more innovative business models. So in the case of the Olafur Eliasson Little Sun, there is the price is much higher in industrialized country, and this finances much lower prices locally, as well as a network of people who take care of selling and servicing those devices. By the way, there is also a solar charger for mobile phones in the same series of products. And then you have other models which are much, much closer to the UNOS type approach of microcredits to buy small a solar installation, again, for individuals, for households, and for little communities. So there is a lot of this happening. Clearly, we would love it to go fast as mobile phones did when they came out. It's taking much longer. but probably I think Rodrigo has joined us. He may be know more of this side of things than myself. What I find very interesting are, you know, examples that have exist since the 1990s, like the Barefoot College, where actually the solar energy education is brought across the world through women who learn to build solar panels and install and use those technologies. So we had lots of bottom-up innovation. This is really extraordinary. On the other hand, and Bruno was mentioning the level of investment, and again, according to this latest number from IEA, they say that actually the kind of budgets would be something like $35 billion to really go and give access to this remaining 610 million people who do not have access to it. So the investments are very, very large, obviously, in areas of the world where the returns of those investments are, as we know, very low. And then there is the other issue of energy poverty. And the energy poverty issue can be solved with similar innovations as the one I just described, but also with other approaches. I've been involved myself in projects that are much more about energy efficiency in that area, and concern the fact that people are educated, people who are suffering from energy poverty, to do the refurbishment and the energy efficiency measures that would really reduce the consumption of the flats, of the houses in which they live. And this is, again, another bottom-up approach, which is incredibly interesting and powerful, because instead of working on the energy supply, one really works on the energy use, making the most of the little energy that that some people can have access to. So I will close here. My point was very much about bottom-up innovation, as you understand. I think that there is lots going on, wonderful opportunities at the educational level, at the technological level, at the business model level. I think we need to look at the space with all its complexity. So this aspect of energy access, as well as this aspect of energy poverty, and look at both the supply of energy as well as the conditions under which energy are used. So more the energy efficiency dimension of the things. And I will close here. Thank you for your attention. Oh, it's Giancarlo. I thought it was Rodrigo. Sorry, Giancarlo.
Thank you very much for your very interesting contribution. I must say I'm not a technician, an engineer, and I'm here only to listen and to learn, with the hope of being able to spread what I will learn in the future. I have an answer. I'm very interested in a subject that is not widely discussed and disseminated now, it seems to me. What are the prospects of high temperature geothermal energy for production of electricity from the technical point of view? In Italy, it seems to be a very interesting situation. But the topic seems to me is not widely discussed and debated.
Yeah. Okay, should I take the floor?
Sure, it's your
floor. Absolutely. Okay, that's a good question, and I'm happy you raised it up, because that's, in a sense, will be the future. Geothermal started even with the, you know, the bears in the cave, which were getting a little bit better climate during winters and so on. But humans did the same, and now we have mainly three groups of applications. Very shallow applications, okay, in the first, let's say, kilometer, mainly to use the heat there for heating and also for cooling, depending upon the enthalpy of the energy you are approaching, then you have the traditional power geothermal production with the turbines from steam, from vapor, from hot fluids and so on. And then you have, I would say, what we are looking for in the future, the supercritical fluids. Fluids at temperatures higher than 374 degrees C, which are able, of course, to give support to plants with a higher efficiency in the energy transformation from the fluids to electricity. And the future is looking to that, and there are several projects around the world, drilling as deep as 4 to 6 kilometers down in the crust and reaching active geothermal areas, which are not, I would say, widely distributed, but you could find active heat concentrated at shallow depth only in active tectonic areas at the plate boundaries, for example, in the mid-ocean ridges and so on. So in Iceland, they try to do that at Krafla, at the Reykjanes Ridge, with drilling wells down to 2 to 4 kilometers.
Yes, sorry to interrupt. We have to close the session. Now we are gonna run on the next session of the energy market. I put the link in the chat. So just closing and join the other session. Sorry for the interruption.
It's really a pity.
Why don't we get in touch and I'll try to answer you on a separate communication on the phone or on email.
Oh yes, thank you. Thank you very much. I can get your address from Domenico.
Okay.
Yeah. And we try to organize a special meeting on this problem, about this topic.
Sure.
Invite me, please. Invite me as well, please.
Goodbye and thank
very
you.
Very nice meeting you. Bye. Bye, Bruno. Bye, Giancarlo.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Francesco. Bye, Domenico.
Bye.
Ciao.
Ciao.